didn't do it.
Today's drama, Susan Glaspell's Trifles, is from 1916. And you can see it in a format, in fact, that was pretty familiar at the time. We'll have some academic papers after the presentation that will talk more about what's in the play. But another thing you may not know about Glaspell is she and her husband, George Cram Cook, were founding members of the Provincetown Players, which is one of the early theatrical groups in this country. And one of the things that they had noticed early in the 20th century is there was not much of an audience or a venue for modern American drama. Who were the new playwrights? Who was writing stuff that people would want to see? So she and her husband, who were living in New York City at the time, spent their summers out in Provincetown, out of Cape Cod. And they started out by reading the plays she had written.
I'm moving
way
wrong.
You can probably hear me
go
back. They started out by reading the plays that she had written just sitting on someone's back porch. And so they would sit around and read the play. Eventually, they got a theater and started to make it a more formal presentation. So what we'll see today is how it must have appeared back in 1916, the first reading through of the play where they sat and the actors read the play together and talked about what it was going to be like, how they were going to do it. By the way, she was inspired particularly with Trifles because one of the new playwrights that she and her husband encouraged had just submitted a play to. And she realized what a good play it was. The playwright was Eugene O'Neill. And she read this play and thought, oh, you know, I've got to write something just as good myself. So she was really spurred on by a lot of these new playwrights who are working today. So we have our cast standing by. I think you'll see their names in the printed program you've got. So please appreciate their hard work. So let's begin and we'll watch Trifles.
Where am I going? I can get something to focus on.
Thank you.
was all quiet inside. I knew it must be up because it was past 8 o'clock. So I knocked again. And then I thought I heard somebody say, come in. I wasn't sure. I'm not sure yet. But I opened the door. This door.
The farmer indicates the door they have all just used and the door where the women remain standing.
And there, in that rocker, sat Mrs. Wright.
What was she doing?
She's just rocking back and forth. She had an apron in her hand and was kind of
And how did she look?
Well, she looked queer.
How do you mean, queer?
Well, as if she didn't know what she was going to do next and kind of done up.
And how did she seem to feel about your coming?
Well, I don't think she minded one way or the other. She didn't pay much attention. I said, how do you do, Miss Wright? It's cold, ain't it? And she said, it is. And just kind of went on cleaning the apron. Well, I was surprised. She didn't ask me to come up to the stove or sit down, but just sat there, not even looking at me. So I said, I want to see John. And she said, and then she laughed. Well, I guess she called him a laugh. I bought a carry out of the cold, and so I said, kind of shocked, can't I see John? No, she said, kind of dull like. Ain't he home? Asked I. Yes, says she, he's home. Then why can't I see him? I asked, out of patience. Because he's dead. Dead, says I. She just nodded her head and not getting a bit excited, but just rocking back and forth. Why, where is he? Says I, not knowing what to say. She pointed upstairs, like that. And I walked from here to there, and I says, what did he die of? He died of a rope around his neck. And just went on cleaning the apron. Well, I went out and called Harry. I thought I might need help. And we went upstairs, and there he was, lying.
I think I'd rather have you go into that upstairs, where you can point it all out. Let's go on now with the rest of the story.
Well, my first thought was to get the rope off. It looked, but Harry, he went up to him, and he said, no, he's dead all right. We better not touch anything. So we went back downstairs. She was still sitting the same way. Has anybody been notified? I asked. No, she says, unconcerned. Who did this, Mrs. Wright? Said Harry. He said, business night. And she stopped leaving the apron. I don't know, she says.
You don't know, says Harry.
No, she says. Weren't you sleeping in the bed with me, says Harry. Yes, she says, but I was on the inside. Somebody slipped a rope around his neck and strangled him, and you didn't wake up, says Harry. Didn't wake up, she said after him. Well, we must have looked as if we didn't see how that could be, but after a minute, she says, I sleep sound. Harry was going to ask us some more questions, but I said maybe we ought to let her tell a story to the coroner or the sheriff. So Harry went as fast as he could up to River's place where there's the telephone.
And what did Mrs. Wright do when she knew that you had gone toward the coroner?
She moved from that chair to this one over here and sat there with her hands held together, looking down. I got a feeling that I ought to make conversation, so I said I'd come to see if John wanted to put in a telephone. And that she started to laugh. And then she stopped and looked at me, scared. I don't know, maybe it wasn't scared. I wouldn't say that it was. Well, soon Carol
around the kitchen slowly, opens the door of a covered closet. He gets up on a chair and looks on the upper shelf, pulling his hand away because it is sticky. The women draw near to get a look at what they may have found.
Here's a nice mess.
Oh, her fruit. It did freeze. She worried about that when it turned so cold. Set the fire go out, her jars would break.
Well, can you beat the women? Hell for murder and worrying about her preserves.
No, I guess before we're through, she may have something more serious than preserves to worry about.
Well, women are all used to worrying over trifles.
And yet, for all their worries, what would we do without the beans?
Women do not unbend as he moves to the sink and takes a dipper full of water from the pail and pours it into a basin, then washes his hands. There is a towel roller near the sink, and he begins to dry his hand and turns the towel looking for a clean spot to use. Disdainfully, he kicks pans stacked on the floor under the sink.
Dirty towels! Not much of a housekeeper, would you say, ladies?
There's a great deal of work to be done on the farm.
Oh, to be sure. And yet, I know that there are some Dixon County farmhouses which do not have such roller towels.
Those towels get dirty awful quick. Men's hands aren't always as clean as they might be.
Loyal to your sex, I see. But you and Mrs. Wright were neighbors. I suppose you were friends, too.
I've not seen much of her of late years. I've not been in this house in more than a year.
And what was that? You didn't like her?
I liked her all well enough. Farmers' wives have their hands full, Mr. Henderson. And then...
Yes?
It never seemed a very cheerful place.
No. It's not cheerful. I shouldn't say that she had the homemaking instinct.
Well, I don't know as Wright had either.
What, you mean that they didn't get on very well?
No, don't mean anything. But I don't think the place would be any cheerful for John Wright's new
instinct. I'd like to talk more about it a little later. I want to get the lay of things upstairs now.
I suppose anything Mrs. Peters does will be all right. She was to take in some clothes for her, you know, and a few little things. We left in such a hurry yesterday.
Yes, but I would like to see what you take, Mrs. Peters, and keep an eye out for anything that might be of use to us.
Yes, Mr. Henderson. The three men leave the kitchen. Unmoving, the women listen to the men's footsteps. Then Mrs. Hale arranges the pans under the sink that the county attorney had shoved out of place.
I'd hate to have men coming into my kitchen, snooping around, criticizing.
She arranges the pans under the sink, which the county attorney had shoved out of place.
Of course, it's no more than their duty. Duty's all right, but I guess that deputy sheriff who came out to make the fire might have a little of this on. Wish I'd thought of that sooner. Seems mean to talk about her for not having things slicked up, and she had to come away in such a hurry.
Mrs. Peters goes to a small table in the left rear corner of the room. She lifts the towel that covers a bowl.
She had bread set.
Mrs. Hale looks out at a loaf of bread beside the bread box and moves slowly towards it.
She was going to put this in there. Shame about her fruit. I wonder if it's all gone. I think there's some here that's all right, Mrs. Peters. Yes, here. This is cherries, too. I declare, I believe that's the only one. She'll feel awful bad after all her hard work in the hot weather. I remember the afternoon I put up my cherries last summer.
She wipes off the bottle and puts it in on the big kitchen table in the center of the room. She moves to sit down in the rocking chair, realizes which chair it is, and with a slow look, steps back. The chair rocks gently back and forth.
Well, I must get those things from the front room closet. You coming with me, Mrs. Hale? You can help me carry them.
They go in the other room and soon reappear. Mrs. Peters carrying a dress and skirt, Mrs. Hale bathroom closet on the table and hurries to the stove.
Light was close. I think maybe that's why she kept so much to herself. She didn't even belong to the ladies' aid. I suppose she felt she couldn't do her part, and then you don't enjoy things when you feel shaggy. She used to wear pretty clothes and be lively when she was Minnie Foster, one of the town girls singing in the choir. But that was 30 years ago. Is this all you was to take in?
She said she wanted an apron. Funny thing to want, for there isn't much to get you dirty in jail, goodness knows. But I suppose just to make her feel more natural. She said they were in the top drawer in this cupboard. Yes, here. And then her little shawl that always hung behind the door. Yes, here it is.
Mrs. Peters.
Yes, Mrs. Carroll.
Do you think she did it?
Oh, I don't know.
Well, I don't think she did it. Asking for an apron and a little shawl, worrying about her fruit.
Mr. Peters says it looks bad for her. Mr. Henderson is awful sarcastic in a speech, and he'll make fun of her saying she didn't wake up.
Well, I guess John Wright didn't wake when they were slipping that rope under him.
No, it's strange. It must have been done awful crafty and still. They say it was such a funny way to kill a man, rigging it all up like that.
That's just what Mr. Hale said. There was a gun in the house. He says that's what he can't understand.
Mr. Henderson said coming out that what was needed for the case was a motive. Something to show anger or sudden feeling.
Mrs. Hale picks up a dish towel and looks at the table. It is half clean and half messy. She moves to finish the cleanup. Looks at the loaf of bread outside the bread box and drops the towel.
Well, I don't see any signs of anger around here. It's right to here. Wonder how they are finding things upstairs. I hope she had it a little more read up there. You know, it seems kind of sneaky. Locking her up in town and then coming out here and trying to get her own house to turn against her.
But Mrs. Hale, the law is the law.
I suppose, Tibbs, better loosen up your things, Mrs. Peters. You won't feel them when you go out.
Mrs. Peters goes to hang her fur tippet on a hook at the back of the room, and there is a small corner table with a sewing basket on it.
She was piecing a quilt.
It's log cabin pattern. Pretty, isn't it? I wonder if she was going to quilt it or just not.
Footsteps are heard coming down the stairs. The sheriff enters, followed by Hale and the county attorney.
They wonder if she was going to quilt it or just not.
Yeah. Well, that spider didn't do much up there, did it? Well, let's go out to the barn and get that here.
The men exit.
I don't know if there's anything so strange about taking up our time with little things while we're waiting for them to get the evidence. I don't see it. Anything to laugh about.
Mrs. Hale smooths out the quilt block.
Of course, they've got awful important things on their minds.
Mrs. Peters, look at this one. Here, this is the one she was working on. And look at the sewing. All the rest of it has been so nice and even. And look at this. It's all over the place. Why, it looks as if she didn't know what she was about.
They look at each other, then glance back at the door. After an instant, Mrs. Hale has pulled out a knot and ripped the sewing.
Oh, what are you doing, Mrs. Hale?
Just pulling out a stitch or two that's not sewed. Very good. Bad sewing always made me fidgety.
I don't think we ought to touch things.
I'll just finish up this end. Mrs. Peters?
Yes, Mr. Hale?
What do you suppose she was so nervous about?
Oh, I don't know. I don't know if she was nervous. I sometimes feel awful queer when I'm just tired. Well, I must get these things wrapped up. They may be through sooner than we think. I wonder where I can find a piece of paper and string.
In that cupboard, maybe.
Mrs. Peters looks in the cupboard.
Why, here's a birdcage.
must have had one, or why would she have a cage? I wonder what happened to it.
I suppose maybe the cat got it.
No, she doesn't have a cat. She's got that feeling some people have about cats, being afraid of them. My cat got in her room, and she was real upset and asked me to take it out.
My sister Bessie was like that. Queer, ain't it?
Why, look at this door. It's broke. One hinge is pulled apart.
Looks as if someone must have been rough with it.
Why, yes.
Mrs. Peters brings the birdcage to the table, placing it near the cherry.
I wish if they're going to find any evidence, they'd be about it. I don't like this place.
But I'm awful glad you came with me, Mrs. Hale. It would be lonesome for me sitting here alone.
It would, wouldn't it? But I tell you what I do wish, Mrs. Peters. I wish I had come over sometimes when she was here. I wish I had.
But of course, you were awful busy, Mrs. Hale. Your house and your children.
I couldn't come. I stayed away because it weren't cheerful. And that's why I ought to have come. I've never liked this place. Maybe because it's down in a hollow and you don't see the road. I don't know what it is, but it's a lonesome place and always was. I wish I had come over to see Minnie Foster sometimes. I can see now.
Well, you mustn't reproach yourself, Mrs. Hale. Somehow, we just don't see how it is with other folks until something comes up.
Not having children makes less work, but it makes a quiet house. And ride out to work all day, and no company when you did come in. Did you know John Wright, Mrs. Peters?
Not to know him. I've seen him in town. They say he was a good man.
Yes, good. He didn't drink. He kept his word as well as most, I guess, and paid his debts. But he was a hard man, Mrs. Peters. Just to pass the time of day with him, a raw wind that gets to the bone. I should think she would have wanted a room. But what do you suppose went with it?
I don't know, unless it got sick and died.
Mrs. Peters reaches over and swings the broken door, then swings it again. Both women watch it.
You weren't raised around here, were you? You didn't know her.
Not until they brought her yesterday.
She, come to think of it, she was kind of like a bird herself. Real sweet and pretty, but kind of timid and fluttery. How she did change. Tell you what. Why don't you take the quilt in with you? It might take up her mind.
Well, I think that's a real nice idea, Mrs. Hale. There couldn't possibly be any objection to it, could there? Now, just what would I take? I wonder if her patches are in here and her things.
They look in the sewing basket and bring out a pretty box.
Here's some red. I expect this has got sewing things in it. What a pretty box. Looks like something somebody would give you. Maybe your scissors are in here. Why, there's something wrapped up in this piece of silk.
Why, this isn't her scissors.
Oh, Mrs. Peters, it's the bird. But Mrs. Peters, look at it. Its neck. Look at its neck. It's all other side, too.
Somebody wrung its neck.
Their eyes meet, a look of growing comprehension of horror. Steps are heard outside. Mrs. Hale slips the box under the quilt pieces and sinks into her chair. The sheriff and county attorney return.
Ladies, have you decided whether she was going to quilt it or not it?
We think she was going to knot it.
Very interesting, I'm sure. Oh, has the bird flown?
We think the cat got it.
Is there a cat?
Well, not now. They're superstitious, you know. They leave.
Well, now, as I was saying, no sign at all of anyone having come from the outside. Their own rope. Now, let's go up again and go over it piece by piece. It would have to have been someone who knew just the...
The sheriff and county attorney go upstairs.
She liked the bird. She was going to bury it in a pretty box. When I was a girl, my kitten, there was a boy who took a hatchet. And before my eyes, and before I could get there, if they hadn't held me back, I would have hurt him. I wonder how it would seem never to have had any children around. No, Wright wouldn't like the bird, the thing that sang. She used to sing. He killed that too. We don't know who killed the bird. I knew John Wright. It was an awful thing that was done in this house that night, Mrs. Hale. Killing a man while he slept, slipping a rope around his neck that choked the life out of him. His neck choked the life out of him. We don't know who killed him. We don't know. If there had been years and years of nothing, then a bird to sing to you, it would be awful still after the bird was still. I know what stillness is. When we homesteaded in Dakota and my first baby died after he was 2 years old and me with no other than...
How soon do you suppose they'll be through looking for the evidence?
I know what stillness is. The law has got to punish crime, Mrs. Hale.
I wish you'd seen Minnie Foster when she wore a white dress and blue ribbons and stood up there in the choir and sang. Oh, I wish I'd come over here once in a while. That was a crime. That was a crime. Who's going to punish that?
We mustn't take on.
I might have known she needed help. I know how things can be for women. I tell you, it's clear, Mrs. Peters. We live close together, and we live far apart. We all go through the same things. It's all just a different kind of the same thing. If I was you, I wouldn't tell her her fruit was gone. Tell her it ain't. Tell her it's all right. Take this in to prove it to her. She may never know whether it was broke or not.
Mrs. Peters takes the bottle, looks about for something to wrap it in. She takes a petticoat from the clothes brought in from the other room. Very nervously, she begins winding this around the bottle.
My, it's a good thing the men couldn't hear us. Wouldn't they just laugh, getting all stirred up over a little thing like a dead canary? As if that could have anything to do with, wouldn't they laugh?
Maybe they would, maybe they wouldn't.
The men are heard coming downstairs and enter the kitchen.
No, no, Peters. It's all perfectly clear, except a reason for doing it. But you know juries, when it comes to women, if there was some definite thing, something to show, something to make a story about it, a thing that would connect up with this strange way of doing it.
Well, I've got to team around. It's pretty cold out there.
I'm going to stay here a while by myself. You can send Frank out for me, can't you? I want to go over everything. I'm not satisfied that we can't do better.
Do you want to see what Mrs. Peters is going to take in?
I guess they're not very dangerous things the ladies have picked out. No, Mrs. Peters doesn't need supervising. For that matter, the sheriff's wife is married to the law. Ever think of it that way, Mrs. Peters?
Not just that way.
Married to the law. I just want you to come in here a minute, George. We ought to take a look at these windows.
Oh, windows.
We'll be right out, Mr. Hale.
Mr. Hale goes outside. The sheriff follows the county attorney into the other room. Then Mrs. Hale rises, hands tied together, looking intensely at Mrs. Peters. make a slow turn, finally meeting. Then her own eyes point the way to where the box is concealed. Mrs. Peters throws back the quilt pieces and tries to put the box into the bag. It is too big, and she opens the box, starts to take out the card, but cannot touch it. She goes to the pieces, stands there helpless. There is the sound of a knob turning in the other room. Mrs. Hale snatches the box and puts it in the pocket of her big coat. The county attorney and sheriff enter the kitchen.
Well, Henry, at least we found out that she was not going to quilt it. She was going to, what is it you call it, ladies?
We call it knot it, Mr. Henderson.
Susan Glaspell's Trifles conveys how insightful the woman truly was as an author. Through the guise of fiction, she freely probes the dark side of human behavior. She explores the issue of domestic violence and reveals how many Fosters Mr. Right turned out to be Mr. Wrong. Glaspell's insights come from her ability to transcend culture, cultural norms, and mores while flying in the face of convention, challenging a society that was not prepared to confront the issue of domestic violence, while at the same time she has become a noteworthy landmark for a society still trying to conquer this fearsome enemy. Glaspell wrote in a time when there was little open discussion about relationships, especially the husband and wife relationship. In fact, women in the first half of the 20th century had very little social or economic standing within society. They were little more than the property of their husbands. When a man beat a woman, there was nothing she could do. There were no battered women's shelters to go to and no state agencies to call. A woman could not look to the police for help. They did not get involved in domestic disputes between a husband and a wife. A woman was not in the position to divorce her husband. Not only was it culturally taboo to do so, but it was economic disaster as well. In effect, a woman living in America in 1916 had no way out of an abusive marriage. She was married until the death of her husband. The character of Minnie Foster is developed to give women of that era a symbol which to identify with. Mrs. Wright is trapped with no way out. She and John are homesteaders. They have no children. They live a solitary life while working the land without any outside help. This, combined with John's temperament and the relationship they both have endured with for the last 30 years, has contributed to his need for control, and the tension created develops into abusive behavior to gain control out of chaos. The reader never sees John physically attack his wife. However, he does model the two phases of the abuse cycle. In the abuse cycle, the tension building stage comes first. And during this phase, anything that goes wrong can and does begin to build up inside the abuser. John, being a homesteader in the Midwest in the late 19th and early 20th centuries, involved a lot of hard manual labor. Much of the ground was rocky, the weather did not cooperate often enough to produce profitable yields. Floods, droughts, and cruel winters were all part of the experience that John and many faced as homesteaders. Man attempting to manipulate nature, now that is chaos. With blood, sweat, and tears, John's work turned into frustration, and frustration built up into tension. John was unable to control nature. So he turned to the one person he could control, his wife. After the tension building phase, an abuser must release all of his anger in some fashion. Psychologists call this the acting out phase. Acting out can manifest itself in various ways. However, no matter how the abuser acts out, its expressed purpose is to take and maintain control. The majority of Glaspell's narrative contains examples of John acting out his anger. John Wright was a hard man, and he used this hardness to his advantage. Being a homesteader, John's natural enemy would have been isolation. He takes this enemy and turns it onto his wife. He began to isolate her by refusing to have a telephone at the farmhouse. Furthermore, his hardness drove friends and neighbors into avoiding the Wright's place. In fact, Mrs. Hale had not been to the house in more than a year. These actions by him kept her from developing any ties separate and apart from the farm. He further ostracized her by the lack of concern he showed in regard to what she wanted. Again, Minnie had to repress her feelings and wants, and as a result, she was all alone, having no contact with anyone, not even her own husband. Mr. Wright's behavior killed Minnie Foster emotionally. There was no love inside of her except the love she showed for that canary. The bird served as a focal point for her, to get her mind off of her own situation in life. In the process, the bird brought Minnie joy and took some of the isolation she faced away. She had something to love while she remained in a loveless marriage to John Wright. He took her social engagements away. She did not even belong to Ladies' Aid. Her individuality was taken. She sacrificed her pretty clothes for a farm. She sacrificed her name for Mr. Wright. She gave him her all, and that was still not enough, and he wanted more. The tension must have been building inside Mr. Wright for a while. Something finally set him off, and he exploded. The first thing he attacked was that which his wife loved, the bird. In a rage, he busted open the bird cage and wrung the bird's neck. Wright exercised his control one more time. He played God with the emotions of his wife, and he chose to play God with the life of a poor, defenseless canary. Trifles is a fictional story with fictional characters. However, Glaspell seems to write what she knows or has been exposed to. The issues explored inside this narrative are real. For the last 2 years, America has been saturated with pictures of Nicole Brown Simpson, who has herself become a symbol of battered wife syndrome. Every year, an estimated 4 million women in the United States are assaulted by their partner. Domestic violence has been called America's little dirty secret. Over 50% of all women will experience physical violence in an intimate relationship at least once. Between 12 to 15% will experience ongoing abuse. and only 10% of abuse episodes are reported to the police. It has been reported that there are 1,500 shelters for battered women in the United States, and there are currently 3,000 animal shelters across the country. Unlike many in John 1997 holds hope, there is help for the battered and the batterer. To truly make a difference, women must be willing to report such abuse, and men must be willing to help, because a batterer cannot, no matter what he promises, and no matter how she wants to believe him, he cannot change on his own. The killing of the canary was the ultimate act of violence. This was just one more thing to repress, another set of feelings to hide. Minnie's natural personality had been lost years ago. With the killing of the bird, everything seemed to rush back. A woman who accepted her fate as Mr. Wright's wife, a woman pushed around by a bully of a husband, finally pushed back. Minnie is pictured like a bird, real sweet and pretty, but kind of timid, a fluttery. And it goes on to say how she did change. Of course she changed. John changed her into what he was, a violent human being releasing pent-up hostility. Society does not expect little birds to attack full-grown men, but there is something ingrained deep within the human psyche, that enough is enough, and the human will begins to take over, and it begins to protect itself. Minnie Foster had enough. The bird was her breaking point. She acted outside of her normal character and protected herself. In the process, she shocked her community. They never expected her to react in this way and kill John Wright. However, she saw no alternative. She took the only way out of the relationship she knew. After spending years in isolation with John Wright on a farm in the middle of nowhere, it seems ironic. She is in jail for his murder, and she is surrounded by other people confined as she is. Susan Glaspell's story functions as good literature should. It captivates the reader while raising some issues that humanity must transcend and correct. Critics argue that literature has an aesthetic quality and it ought to remain in the aesthetic realm. It is not the only function of literature to be beautiful. This medium has the power to transcend mere cold hard fact, which detach and desensitize a reader. It has the power to change the way men and women view domestic violence, or any other issue for that matter. Changing women's lives for the better is a long process. Men have some behavioral modifications to go through before women are honored and treated as equals. For those women who endure abuse, it seems to last forever. Victims of this kind of abuse need to be taken to the light that dispels the darkness. Trifles can be admired as a beautiful piece of literature. It is that, but it is so much more. Men and women both can let it be a catalyst today for change. Thank you.
Graduate student in secondary ed. In fact, she even brought one of her students with her today. So please welcome Anita.
The title of my work is not such a trivial work, Susan Glaspell's Trifle. At the beginning of her writing career in Davenport, Iowa, Susan Glaspell worked as a reporter for the local newspaper. One assignment called for her to report on the trial of a woman accused of murder. Her investigation for the story included a visit to the crime scene, a farmhouse kitchen. She never forgot how the kitchen looked or how she felt being there. Years later, challenged by the opportunity to write a play that would be performed with one of Eugene O'Neill's works, she stared at an empty stage, envisioned that Iowa farmhouse, and created Trifles. The play's setting and the attitudes of the male characters reflect Glaspell's Midwestern upbringing, although Trifles was written after she had moved to Greenwich Village. Skillfully woven into this murder story are conflicts based on sexism, an isolated setting, and thought-provoking metaphors that spotlight the conflicts and reveal truths. Glaspell uses Trifles to voice her opinion of a society that cages women in roles built and maintained by men. Sexism, the main conflict, is indicated in the way the men speak to and about the women in the play. Even the title reflects how men view women. A trifle is something small with no consequence. Mrs. Hale's husband, one of the minor characters, is a man who at first is sympathetic with Minnie Wright because he knows what a tough tightwad John Wright had been. As the story progresses, Mr. Hale sides with the men. His final comment in the play is a deprecating one. Well, women are used to worrying over trifles, and places him squarely on the side of the men. His sympathy for Minnie Wright buried under allegiance to his sex. Trifles was written in 1916, long before the modern women's movement began. And through the dialogue, Glaspell describes the lives and concerns of women living in any male-dominated society. The true conflict in the story is male versus female, where the men insist on logic and masculine superiority, while the women judge Minnie from love and sympathy. Empathy for Minnie Wright comes through statements from Mrs. Peters and Mrs. Hale as they examine Minnie's kitchen. Commenting on the women characters in Trifles, Arthur Waterman observes that they are a jury of Minnie's peers, women who know what a woman can suffer and what she must do to escape tyranny. Mrs. Hale and Mrs. Peters, two women who appear to be opposites, join together with no motivation other than understanding. Through their speech, the men belittle the women's interests and intelligence, but the women, through their speech, join together as a solid support for a woman in trouble. Glaspell creates sympathy for Mrs. Wright not only through dialogue, but by setting this story in a cold, isolated farmhouse in the dead of winter. Loneliness and quiet pervade the story, and although Minnie Wright never appears, she is a very present personality. This was Minnie Wright's entire world: a worn-out stove, threadbare clothing, a chair with a broken rocker, and a dinginess throughout lend atmosphere to the setting and magnify the abusive relationships the Wright shared. Minnie Wright rarely socialized, and neighbors did not feel like coming over. The setting is best summed up by Mrs. Hale. "I could have come," she said. "I stayed away because it weren't cheerful, and maybe that's why I ought to have come. I've never liked this place. It's down in a hollow and you don't see the road. It's a lonesome place and always was." All of the action takes place inside the Wright's farmhouse kitchen, the center of a rural wife's existence. Barging into Minnie Wright's kitchen are three men who seem to have already decided on her guilt, and two women who compare their own married lives and their own kitchens with Minnie's unkempt one. Sexism is revealed in the way the men speak condescendingly about Minnie's kitchen and the trivial things that concern women. As they wait in the kitchen, the two women's thoughts and plans are interrupted several times as the men pass through the room. These interruptions break the rapid climb to the climax and add tension as the women listen to the footsteps overhead or voices just outside the door. Yet the focal point is not the room itself, but the things the women see and find in the kitchen, with the men hovering just off stage. In addition to the use of dialogue and setting, Glaspell uses symbolic metaphors to portray Minnie Wright: the broken jars of fruit, the dead canary in its cage, and the crazily stitched quilt piece all represent the woman accused of murder. Each is considered trivial by the men, but offers telltale evidence when analyzed by Mrs. Peters and Mrs. Hale, and each is a physical representation of Minnie Wright's sad emotional life. The shattered jars of cherries that had exploded in the freezing cold of the kitchen emphasized the fact that Minnie Wright had endured the coldness of her marriage until she, too, exploded. Glaspell uses the dead bird to symbolize the figurative death of the many Mrs. Hale used to know. How she did change, muses Mrs. Hale, and describes Minnie before her marriage to John Wright as like a bird herself, real sweet and pretty, but kind of timid and fluttery. As John Wright strangled his wife's beloved bird, he strangled his wife's spirit. The bird cage is also representative of the role women are forced into in a male-dominated society, and Minnie, the bird, was trapped in an abusive marriage in the same way the bird was caged. Glaspell makes the point that there is only so much a woman can take until she, like any other human, breaks under the strain. Finally, attention is drawn to the quilt Minnie Wright was piecing, a practical project for a farm wife, but something usually not done alone. Mrs. Hale wonders if Minnie was going to quilt it or just knot it, and Glaspell uses this question to subtly introduce a play on words filled with irony. Mr. Wright was hanged for his crimes using a rope. The image of a murderer hanging for his crimes includes a rope with a hangman's knot. More importantly, the radical change in the stitching of the quilt, from smooth and neat stitches to uneven, tightly pulled loops, signaled a radical change in Minnie. Something had happened to upset her, and Mrs. Hale was the first to discover this evidence. The pieces of the quilt call attention to the way the two women piece together the evidence of the motive for murder. This quilting and knotting explains that knotting is much easier for one person to do. Considering Minnie Wright's lonely life, knotting the quilt would have been her choice. Although the county attorney is amused at the idea that Minnie Wright was going to knot the quilt, he is thinking that the final result of the murder investigation will be a guilty verdict that sees Mrs. Wright executed for the murder of her husband. Later expanded into the short story, A Jury of Her Peers, Trifles was originally written for production by the Provincetown Players, a little theater group owned by Glaspell and her husband, George Graham Cook. Considered to be her most important work because of its timelessness, message, and design, Trifles has been resurrected in recent years from the attic of women's literature. Some critics whine that Glaspell produced mediocre work that is being revived only because of the scarcity of quality in women's literature today. By analyzing the intricate stitching together of the stitches in the play, of the pieces of the play, modern readers of Glaspell's Trifles will see that this work is not a light blanket to be brought out simply because the bed of women's literature seems to need more cover.
Our final paper this afternoon is from a graduate student in English, Helen Wishart, who says she has a feminist response to this.
In her brief play, Trifles, Susan Glaspell sets up the tensions between the main characters to reflect the wider tensions in a patriarchal society which demeans both the work and life of women and values the occupations and subjectivities of men. This masculist ethos is demonstrated by the conflict between the protagonist, Mrs. Hale, who represents not only the female voice in the play, but also an ethic of care and connection, and the antagonist, the county attorney, George Henderson, who is the official representative of an ethic of rights and individualism, male-defined and male-executed. That his role is broader than that of the particular agent of retributive justice in this community in the Midwest is illustrated from the beginning by the fact that he is almost exclusively referred to by his title, county attorney, rather than his personal name. The gradual bonding of the women in their attempt to save Minnie Foster from him as the events of her life unfold through the trifling evidence of kitchen things is presaged immediately in the play. Even as the women enter the kitchen, the domain of the accused, they maintain a distance from the men. When the county attorney begins the interrogation of Mr. Hale, the first step in the gathering of the evidence necessary for conviction, Glaspell groups Mrs. Peters, Mrs. Hale, and the absent Mrs. Wright, as symbolized by the rocker, opposite the group of men who are strangers to the life represented here. Already, the tension between the two groups is palpable. The misunderstanding of a woman's emotional mood is particularly underlined by the factual recounting of Hale's conversation with Mrs. Wright before he discovers Wright's death. His use of descriptors such as not getting a bit excited and unconcerned dramatically describe someone who is in shock, emotionally flat, and incapable of dealing with the consequences of her actions. The attorney, of course, misses the significance of her emotional state in his search for important evidence which would point to a motive and therefore ensure her conviction. The other representative of the law, the sheriff, also identified by his role in society, devalues Mrs. Wright's life work by mocking her concern for her preserves, held for murder and worrying about her preserves. Hale joins the fraternal ignorance with his comment, "Women are used to worrying about trifles." The women move closer together. The battle lines are in place. Again, the men miss the emotional cues. Even the seemingly gallant comment, "What would we do without the ladies?" by the attorney, is facetious, indicating no real respect for the essential labor in the private realm that supports the important work of the public life he leads. Mrs. Hale's resentment of this devaluing of all women's work flares in her answer to his comment about the dirty towel. "Men's hands aren't always as clean as they might be." The attorney reads this comment as simple loyalty to her sex, her kind, rather than the indictment of his ignorance it was meant to be. His dismissal of Mrs. Wright's homemaking instinct, as well as her housekeeping abilities, again incite Mrs. Hale to defend Mrs. Wright. Although she accepts the cultural expectations that women are defined by their success in the private sphere, she also knows that these expectations are sometimes beyond the women's capacity to fulfill, especially when the other occupant of the home is like Mr. Wright. Her rebuttal of the attorney's negative judgments is subtle but telling, couched as it is in negative terms. I don't think a place would be any cheerfuler for John Wright's being in. The antagonism between Mrs. Hale and the attorney is now firmly established, and his request for anything that might be of use is unlikely to be met with cooperation. After the men, the representatives of law and order, leave the kitchen, the women investigate the kitchen things belonging to Minnie Foster and gradually reconstruct the isolated life Minnie Foster led while married to the man who was considered good by male definitions, but like a raw wind that gets to the bone, by Mrs. Hale. As Mrs. Hale examines her memory of Minnie Foster as a young girl, sweet, pretty, and a singer, she creates the picture of a gentle creature, bird-like herself, without the resources necessary to withstand the constant emotional and psychological, if not physical, brutality of Wright. The evidence for the motive of the crime emerges from the anomalous sewing of the quilt patch, the broken birdcage door, and finally the bird itself, gently wrapped for burial in the best manner Minnie Foster could manage in her barren circumstances. The commonality of Minnie Foster's circumstances and those of Mrs. Peters in her loss of first a pet kitten to wanton brutality and then her child are dramatically presented. The tension within Mrs. Peters is a reprise of the tension within Mrs. Wright when Hale first speaks of her. Mrs. Peters knows the law. She, after all, is married to the law. But it is a law defined by men who have missed the significance of the circumstances of the life of Minnie Foster as she was gradually forced into Mrs. Wright. And inevitably, the care and concern for human connection which Mrs. Hale articulates, "I wish I could come over to see Minnie Foster sometimes," motivates Mrs. Peters to hide the crucial evidence which would send the accused to death. The justice the women choose is not the justice of their husbands or the representatives of the law of the land. Significantly, the women do not choose to discuss their findings with men. Intuitively, they both know that the decision they have made to act according to what is right reason, kataton archon logon, as the ancient Greeks phrased it, will collide with the judgment the men would make, given the evidence of the kitchen things. They well understand the value of their persons and their labor relative to that of males in the greater social order. They feel the difference. The county attorney stands for an ethic of duty, an abstract ideal of justice based on objective evaluation of available evidence. After all, a man's life has been taken, and as Mrs. Peters tries to convince herself, the law has got to punish crime. But Mrs. Hale identifies another kind of crime, and her cry from the heart succeeds in bonding the women in their understanding, because both know the answer to her question, who's going to punish that? Only the concerted effort of the women could reduce the authority of the agent of retribution, the county attorney. And so, the play ends with a touch of irony. The means of death is spoken aloud. The resistance of the women is articulated in a final pun, and the attorney loses his patriarchally delegated role and is reduced to playing Mr. Henderson.
So if anyone has any observations or comments or questions of any of the presenters today or any comments from after having seen the reading, this is a good time for it. Any questions?
Hi, I'm wondering if you in any way understand that the ethics of care is less
as a contradiction,
me coming from a psychological viewpoint, my background is religion and theology, so that may seem to be an apparent contradiction. But the relationships between men and women on both sides of the gender gap or gender issue are motivated by the way that we treat each other. The way that John Wright, treated his wife should be a, hopefully a clue, for guys that, that read this play, that is the wrong way to go about it. Their relationship affected her greatly. And how can you not help but see a psychological change in her because of all of the things that she was exposed to, from Mr. Wright, who turned out to be Mr. Wright. But does that answer your question or not?
Yeah.
Okay. Do you want to talk about how you came up taking your approach to it?
I chose mine. I have known somebody very close to me who was in a relationship like this. And when I was reading this for the first time and saw about the cherries that had exploded, the jar of cherries, I thought about how cold it was going in her house. And I thought that, I did not know that this, when I first read it, I did not know it had been written in 1916. I thought it had been written in 1986 when a friend of mine was going through her trouble because her house was like that. And I felt like Mrs. Hamby, it was hard to go into my friend's house even though I knew she needed help. The quote I used on mine was from Lillian Hellman's Watch on the Line, and it ties into what you said about recognizing the guilt that Mrs. Hale felt guilty about not ministering to this friend. For every man who lives without freedom, the rest of us must face the guilt. And I know that that's what she was going through, because that's the way I felt when my friend was going, and I couldn't reach her. There's no way.
When I was asked to do a paper for this, and I was told what it was going to be over, I could kind of thumb through it the first time and say, "Oh, that's nice," Then I read it a second time, a little more closely, and when I read it the second time, and the point that just impacted me with this play was at the point when they opened up the box and found the canary. That may seem strange, it may not. But at that point, I had the perspective from where I wanted to come with this, and about the perspective on Mr. Wright.
Any other questions? We're running out of time today here. We'd be happy, I know the panel's been willing to say a few more things, but I don't want to keep you late for next sessions.
Yes, our concurrent sessions start now. Could I remind you, though, please? At 8 o'clock this evening, we have a reading by Jen Stewarty from her new book. There are copies hot off the press in the lobby. We're seeing it first, and also a performance by very dancing dramatic folks from the design arts. Thank you very much. Enjoy the concurrent session.
All right, you can get there. intermittently says she, Maggie. Jared Lovering is playing the part of Paul and Chorus. Shay Grant is playing Chorus. I will be playing narrator, Cynthia, and Curandero. The excerpt being presented today is from three of the five acts in this play. In Act Two, Maggie has reached a decision regarding her life. The scene takes place at a house and the adjoining creek bottom in a rural area near San Antonio, Texas. In Act Three, the final moments of her marriage unfold. They take place at the house. Act Five portrays the unfolding of a new person and takes place in Victoria, Texas, at a church and at a house that she, Maggie, has rented. We begin with Act Two, Scene Two, entitled Remaking B. Cynthia speaks.
Well, this is heavy duty thinking take going on here.
Oh, I didn't hear you coming.
Well, the gate was open, and you haven't let your guineas out yet to announce folks.
Sold those guineas. A bit less livestock to keep track of.
Well, that's a change. She picks up a prayer book and looks at it. It's lying next to Maggie and says, what's this?
I've been rereading my marriage vows. Ever notice how only the woman gets a ring?
Well, I never noticed.
I wonder, is it like the ring put into a slave's right ear in New Testament times?
Why are you reading this, Maggie?
Does this ring bind my heart? Have I been loving and cherishing and bringing up children in the faith?
What?
I must be doing something wrong. I must be...
Well, Maggie,
I must be making a mistake. The so long as you both shall live is getting too damn long.
Oh, I know what's wrong. Paul forgot your anniversary, right?
Yeah, well.
So, let's go out. I'll go get up.
No, I've got something to do. Don't want to go out.
You want to speak your mind about this?
Don't have a mind to speak.
In that case, call me later, girl. She exits. Self speaks. She, Maggie, goes into the house, and in the bedroom, she rummages until she finds a bottle and a sweater.
Friday afternoon, she willed the world to end. Yes, Friday afternoon was the proper time. Saturday morning would be too late. Saturday mornings, the migraines started. Headaches, the reason she wanted the world to end. She was finished with headaches. She had beaten her head against the wall enough times, entrenched herself in bed, retreated under the covers, twisted and flailed like a colicky horse, sweated, vomited, inched through the weekend in a beaten, punched shuffle. She would end doings that brought headaches. She wanted her world to end.
She, Maggie, now walks to the front door, stops. She goes to the bedroom and takes one long look, focused on the wooden folding screen.
I wagered, not knowing what to take account of. I am not given to games of chance, did not hazard. My pledge was not a gamble. Thus, pledging to another, I will abide. I do not fear to pledge. I believe in your certainty. I believe you are the wellspring of my life. Wellsprings do not pour forth from forged flint. Flint forged by woman will striving to earn her wages. Love bought too high a price has rendered me barren.
She leaves the door open. The openness that is the customary gesture. For she always intends to return when she reads the electric meter, or sweeps the porch, or gets the mail, or waters the flowers hanging from porch posts. But today, who she is has no intention of returning. The open door is meant to give all that bears her name time to gather its presence and leave. She passes the trash barrel, walks between the garden beds of cucumber, okra, corn, past the chicken yard, and down the fence line. She empties the brain cage to flush out a spider passes the leaning elm tree.
Damn forces cribbing on that trunk again.
Rests at its windowsill branches and sighs her refrain of longing.
Outposts for fledglings testing their wings. Once only a leaning place between shores, I aim to go past.
On the slope towards the creek, she pushes her way through the bloodweeds and dewberry bushes. Somewhere in the tangle,
whew, Dennis finishing up its business. How appropriate, a pearl prophet preparing the way.
The smell is just that, a smell, not the boiling, frothing deadness that doesn't let anything escape its choking power. She goes to the creek bed and sits on the concrete stone ledge that during high water hones a wake of gurgle and song.
She takes off her sweater, wraps it around her neck, and then removes it abruptly, throws it down. Then she proceeds to undress. The chorus, in embarrassment, moves to screaming.
The cloak of Elijah cannot fall on one who stops before the journey's end, one who pledged, as the Lord liveth, as thy soul liveth, I will not leave thee, has lost sight and lost the gift. So now, she who has stumbled must make her own way out of the darkness of her desperation.
She pours ashes on her head and with ritual care rubs them onto her arms and her face and her neck. She imagines and stands and raises her arms and stands with her legs in an open stance.
Ledge rock carved by water, cleaving the water. I declare you the ground of power.
Take nigh into your hands forbidden powers.
Upon which my issue of words will come, so shall my words be that go forth out of my mouth. They shall not return unto me void, but shall accomplish that which I please, and shall prosper in the thing whereto I send them.
Remember, you are in the temple of God. Do not defile yourself.
Submit yourself. Be subject.
Don't be blown first one way, then another. Guard against idle thoughts, faithless despair.
Remember him for whom you were created, under whose covering you live.
You will become a byword.
You will live with shame.
She then takes a pill bottle, removes the cap, and pours the contents of it into her mouth.
In the end is word. The word is with me. The word is me. With my word, everything is not. Now, let me mind what I have done. The end is. It is good.
She, Maggie, lies down and spreads her arms to the side, adjusting her clothes under her head for comfort, and awaits her end.
Quiet foams and backwashes like the undertow of ebb tide and claims what my word has uncreated. The emerging void is possum pouch perfect. Ah, a pocket whose folds and gathers are deepened by black velvet darkness shining from an echo room within me. Quiet. Feathered. Darkness that finally gives rest. Light. eternity has freedom to take its time. And afterwards, I will rise and go my way, a way surely as plain to follow as the course of the planets around the sun.
Maggie.
Annunciation. Time lapsing in soundless vaulting, the obsidian calm of cavernous cathedral chambers blooms beneath ionic sediments.
Honey, you down there?
Sidewalk rhythms, workplace orchestrations, social bisagrias, intermezzos of intimacy become distillates that no longer lure.
Hey, you need any help down there?
Paul sees Maggie, comes closer, turns one way and then the other, and exits again.
But condense as ink-washed scenes on domes glistening, unreflected, that curl under ledge lips, cling, gather, drip in dot-dash space, drops, rupture, atop half-filled columns, roll mercurial, pool riddle down, seep into the floor, spore rose mold, copper tarnished lichen. She of moss mysteries, who clothes rocks with belt-flecked overgarments, offers me a cushion of yucca blossom leathers, bringing me dishes of honeycomb and plantains, while simple shivers rise from deep waters to the eye of the dome, she who fills and empties, aspects her transparent blue iciness, invites me to dance, whose steps I learn as I forfeit the certitude of gravity, the singleness of self. With each successive pass, she hands me another of herself, still clasping my hands in hers, until I no longer know which dancers reflect the dancers of the dance, adorned in a glowing vestment of lightning buckling, winged sleeves of lace, luna moth scales. She of morning dew gathers the shimmering liquid light, a drink offering. As she puts the grace cup to my lips, she keeps.
Paul enters and props the prostrate, naked body of Maggie up, trying to get her to drink some water.
She who subdues water becomes sovereign. She who subdues and governs the water must be given up into it. With each successive swallow of what the light fades, I am troubled. What manner of greeting is this to one who fears water's urgency, rhythm, depth? Of the breath of the Annunciation, she who fills and empties takes me by the eye, pirouettes from streetlight to streetlight until we reach the river, the bridge. She dips into her floating mirroring, ripples to the rapids, and mixes with the churning foam, becomes foam, green curled froth. Her iridescent glowing, the rising spray haunts lovers embracing.
Paul finally picks Maggie up, carries her into the house as the lights fade. Act three, the undoing. Scene one, tell tape. The lights are up in the kitchen, and Paul sits at the table, having a drink. Next to him are several boxes with their lids off. He is visibly distracted while looking through the family phone book. Self stands outside the house, and the chorus begins.
Tell-tale in black and white. Autobiographic notebooks, dossiers of thoughts have become the adversaries. Reliquary are opened so that accounts might be rendered into truth. Their positions disclose cause and effect. Ledgers can be balanced and justified.
Paul gets up and uses the phone.
Cynthia, did you see Maggie today? What did she say to you? Anniversary? No woman's going to try to kill herself on account of her old man forgetting her anniversary. Well, there's got to be some reason she went off and did what she did. Yeah, she'll be okay. They pumped her out. She had to be in the hospital a few days, though. Sure, go see her.
He hangs up and he goes into the bedroom and rummages through some of the stacked boxes. He opens a notebook, flips through pages, and stops at an entry.
Flea market romance. I was setting up, ready to sell my rubbish in booth 54A, when I saw you holding old books crammed into banana boxes. I yelled across the aisle, my life is sorted in tomato boxes. Some never try for the limit, I did. Daring drunk I was and flushed out of pipe, never saw you again. Just then, in your presence, I was giddy. Beyond the walls I built, I felt accepted tenderness, touch I had not wrought. Conscience has not outweighed the passion I've had to confess. My fault, my own grievous fault. Does the shame at my loss of virtue mean my passion was a mistake? I do feel foolish sometimes when I think about it all. But no, I won't deny passion's moment, monument like a sphinx in the desert, refusing to be forgotten. Foolish, giddy, refusing to be forgotten, I'll be damned if this isn't the limit.
He scoops up what he can and he takes it down to the trash can. He returns, and then he gathers his shaving things and leaves. Act 3, Scene 2, Remaking Being, a reprise. Enter Maggie with the pails. You see she's been out milking the goats. Self follows, and Self stands over her shoulder and reads.
The sweet smell of creamy foam crinkling and settling on top of milk.
Like an old catfish who wallows in the deepest mud hole of a stock tank that doesn't dry up even in the droughtiest stretches, I've been shoving my whiskered mouth into the murky, soft, silted galactic mud, and without so much as noticing, I'm born again. I gather the algae coolness around my shoulders and study the newness of myself. The mesquites, cottonwoods, the willows are leaning into each other's shadows and have taken on the look of old senoras off to church to make their confessions and offer penances of beads. The goat trail to the creek lays like a tow line across the Bermuda grass, and the nannies stand in the mulberry grove watching their kids headbutting in the pen. How good it was to have the nannies crowd around for rations and rushing. How comforting their letting down my touch. Extra molasses feed all around. Sucked dry by their kids, they settle onto the manure-packed mound like a family reunion picture pose.
The phone rings.
Hi, Cynthia. Yeah, I'm home. No, nobody's here. Paul left a note at the hospital that he was fed up, took the kids to his mother's. Don't know where he is. Guess he's okay. He wouldn't have trouble finding a place to stay. No, he hasn't called. I haven't been home all that long. Want to come over? It'll be pork chops and eggplant. I'll set the kettle to boil for some coffee. Please come and eat with me. That skillet tune of pork fat is going to make me as lonesome as a Hank Williams cheating song. Okay, well, maybe tomorrow.
She's got nothing to do now but mind. She minds the stirring in her brain that's as shy as the critters she hears in the feed bins but never show themselves from behind the leafy clover of vines and briars grown up between the sun-warped slats of goat barn. Amid steam and scald and doing dishes, she minds. Her newness, bold, cautious, scuttles away from sane thoughts, melts into the silt shallows of feeding.
Well, House, I guess you and I are going to have to get used to the ache in the night for the company of bare feet and tussling child bodies.
The lights dim to black. Act 3, Scene 3, Fruits of Her Hands. This scene takes place downtown San Antonio. The chorus speaks as Maggie and Paul stand afar.
It is at the corner of Commerce and Buena Vista. A woman rushes up and sobs.
All over her husband's medium starched pinstripe shirt closed at the neck of the blue diagonal tie. Her flowing words.
What do they all mean?
Drift down his briefcase, splatter on the FedEx envelope protecting urgent papers.
She bleeds there, shrouded in her San Antonio Rough Rider's poncho. All of us embarrassed, still, watching in wonderment, seeing the exposed, admonishing palms.
Hearing those words, words that have been growing for weeks.
In that planter box of bleeding hearts by the front door, next to the green astroturf welcome.
I was granted just one birthright, the call covering my head. They who are born without the privilege of legitimacy are often given a gift with which they make a place and a personhood others have by fortuitous birth. For me, imagination was the gift of that call. One day, your covering became more frightening than the power of the call I yielded. Without telling you, not knowing how or what to ask return, I took the dowry back. To my surprise, you sensed its loss. I never knew that you put the gift to use. You became obsessed to possess it and me. Enraged when I would not return and you were sure that I had given the dowry to another. You rummaged through the house, even the trash bin filled with sun-baked rank waste of spent days, for witness that you've been betrayed by madness, lust. But my dowry is not, as you think, squandered on another. I've claimed it to breathe life into a self waiting to be.
Those words, so rehearsed, so steady, what do they all mean? What does she want them to do? Begin once with her. Stared straight ahead, jaws set, neck ligaments tight, veins deepening. He shifted the briefcase and the man got into his truck.
She, Maggie, stands alone.
Righteousness. Perched above your altar in grief, intoning canticles, seeking pardon, I smell the carrion of your trust fell in brushlands of my hearing and observe ordained sacrifices. Be before mesquites, crumble to snags in the arroyo. Near a root crotch, trap spiders rend their beetles. Wasp broods dodder on flint banks, suck spider hosts. Your adamant antiphon accuses, you cheated, woman, I've been cheated. Cheated woman, true, and brass true.
The lights fade to black. Act 5. Kurandara approaches. The scene changes to a house in Victoria, Texas, where Maggie has moved. Maggie is speaking to the Kurandara, who happens to be a maid, a neighbor, and also a Mexican healer of a Mexican community. Buenos dias, senor.
Maggie.
Hi there. It's good to see someone living in this house. She's been sad standing empty. Senora,
Maggie.
Are you buying the house, Maggie?
I'm only renting.
Until
I figure out what.
I see. Well, I have been meaning to bring you some tortillas and powder. Mucho gusto. Welcome. Welcome to the neighborhood.
Gracias. Adios, senora.
Vera. Maggie puts the food on the porch and she goes back to the fence and speaks across it to the audience as if she were giving a guided tour.
I've come to that unheeded part of town that the railroad knows. Here, there is no going over or under the trestle. Shanty rows, clogged dead-end streets, butted up against cinder steeps, barren by dousings of diesel. This is the wilderness where I must claim my birthright or perish. At the river bend, where a dock once made bridge and water street, thoroughfares of commerce, shaded by trees and trestles, sits a house, its siding the moon-set yellow of spent gardenias.
Self comes from the window and stands in back.
I am grateful for this house, this porch, this soul to cover back taxes a lot, claimed by tight familial groups of bearded irises, purple on purple and buff-speckled speechless tongues, near the fence post by the mailbox, larkspur ragged from caterpillar scavengers and burst seed pods, leaning in like mindedness with clean and queen anne's lace, whose gray sticky seed head
black, carrying her work things over her arm, she opens the heavy door, just then unlocked. I listen to her steps echo between the narthex and the confessionals to the altar of the Pietà. She gazes on Our Lady of Sorrows. Her prayers trickle like water squeezed from fern-veiled rocks. Kyrie spilled as over roots, whirl in a pebble tied to the altar, reflective wooden ark of holiness. At each station, kneeling, remembering, reciting, kissing the hands and feet of Our Lady's Son, she trembles.
Mother of sorrow, whose heart turned not away from the sword, pray for my daughter.
She laments.
Mother of grief, whose eyes did not hide from the pain, pray for my daughter.
She weeps.
Mother of loss, whose arms dare lift her dead son, pray for my daughter.
Our Father, act of consecration, Gloria. She lingers, her hands smooth the petition polished rail, tucking a votive vision, her supplication on the lips of the Virgin, into her heart. She opens the hand-wrought portal of her day.
Curandera moves to stand behind the sheep.
But I stare into waiting.
Many thirst, yet do not always ready to drink of deep-drawn waters, offered them by those who have become servants of the mysteries. They look into the dipper, and they see only grains rubbing against grains, etching into enamel sides with sand, seed, sediment. The water up in that sand, they do not see, fear to see. They turn away, never tasting the miracle of grit upon the lips and tongue changed to deep strong water in the throat. Oh, Olamic, silence, more to be dreaded than a curse of snakes, more to be eschewed than riddles. Those who have drunk from sand become sand. Become water, yearn to pour the mystery into another's heart so that to gain compañeras for that desert where is a hermitage. But compañeros for those barons abide only when the gift and gesture of the water bearers are understood, revealing water where others see sand.
Not even manna does she offer.
Lest you empty the mystery of its threat and also of its beauty.
The imperatives that once drummed the cadence are silent. The sickle moon threads night through her eye, mends the tattered herringbone weave of gulf clouds with threads spun from down, shed by a night bird, and turns away into her private sphere. I have become a soul without seasons. I walk the path of darkness, escorted by silence who speaks no comfort, solitude who offers no vision, dearth whose touch paralyzes. Between millstones, benefit of birthright and community of covenants, I have become grains of sand that are powerless in their own weight, and the wind, being shifted, being shaped, ever sifting, drifting into cracks filling tombs where a mute trickle measures neither the blink of an eye nor the rotation of galaxies. I have become the sifted sifter of grains. I am she who bakes stone bread in the darkness, using granite meal ground from the cliffs I once clenched. Now ground and sifted and measured, mounds shift by the touch of the wind, by the dervish axis dance of day and night. Massives held in awe, no longer. Their permanence underfoot, shaken out of shoes. I have become the solitary in defilement upon this decayed rock, ears sheared with velocities of voices, eyes blighted with cinematized specters, and endured the demons of my fear. She who would be sovereign,
she who is sovereign, must bow even in shunning, in silence, in darkness, to abide in her waiting.
Oh, that I would sing again and dance among the graces.
She who would dance with them must first dance the silence of ravenous madness, dance the solitude of wind and hollow bones, dance the dearth of flint yearning to birth water, dance because she chooses, dance upon the sifted remains from which she makes her feast.
Kurandara enters as self exits.
Mira, Our Lady of Sorrows, standing upon your crescent moon, behold my despair, a woman bereft, alone. Make me safe, love me.
Well, safety is mezcal. When life is hymns of garments, mud and spittle, loaves and fishes, stone pillows of prayer, calming the terror, when life has no more weed to ravel, has become the frayed thread of unwinding from itself, and you have become the sand grain on the camel's lash. Then the needle's eye comes into focus.
I retreat under the grieving ledge of my shoulders, seek visions in my wakeful terror, swallow wine of thorns, sing, chant, sing, become the priestess who carries the cure for loneliness dangling from her waist, reliquary beads filled with tears and scorpion venom, 5 decades and 2 clods of clay, cinch my purple skirt that sweeps the ground before and after my bare feet that toe out the path of dark strength wrapped in a pouch dangling from my belt.
You have made this void from the mercies it contains. Self dances alone before she.
From grief's knotted dunes forming my core, she rises. A licorice ohm clings to her teeth, juices her gums. Her smile is the lumbago of a snake-hip dance of clapping hands. Her hardened nipples trace circles under the magnet red blouse. This woman knows her body. Her chibi-bitin kisses fire at my lips. This woman claims her body. Her tongue invites communion with the omamic well. When she mouths the om, she does not cozen her place in the world. She takes it as her right. Her om swirls like hot honey and fills the dipper to overflowing.
Self stops her dance and approaches she.
Introductions. So you look up, startled at the hello that rings unfamiliar in this solemnness. You can't imagine how I found my way into your solitude. Bending my arms, beating with my right hand, smiling like a carny seeing an easy mark. You look perplexed, tightening your middle, stiffening your spine, retreating into your cue. Not to worry, you're in no danger of being duped. I bring great joy. Compose yourself. Look at me. Go ahead. Size me up. Consider who you see. My eyes straight into yours, my face, suncatcher bright, my throat in deep perpetual shade, to dangle earrings and antennae to worlds whose voice we have become. When my lips tremble as I speak, think reverence, think awe, never again think fear or uncertainty.
She, self, Kurandara, all leave the church as she and self finally unite as one entity. Act 5, Scene 4, She Who Subdues. Self enters. She comes onto the stage with a basket. She puts the notebook on the chair and goes with self to the ledge rock.
Who has heard and seen such things? At once being born and bare, soon as she herself was, she travailed and brought forth, she found a way to her birthday and has become one waiting for.
She who subdues.
She who subdues.
Brings forth. Her womb has opened.
I have freshened. I am a pomegranate. A trove of seeds spilling from white flesh burst open from its own ripeness.
I flatten my nakedness onto a calm I command. The timpani of seven oceans, fathomless bowl of onyx covered with a tight stretched basil of motionless rock, melts to rhythm beneath my touch. I press my ear into its undulations, taste its glistening overtones. I watch the waves of my movements burn, channel the energy that cradles land and moves air and wait for its readiness of my creating.
I rise and begin the dance of my communion with worlds whose fusions make realities and voids of which I am no longer afraid. I am she who is a lover of all things, a lover who loses herself in the embrace of the terrible and the beautiful, and a lover who fills another's womb, and a lover who midwives new life, and a lover who wraps the shroud onto those she has birthed, embraced, mated, killed. I dance the fusion of shame and glory that brands and beatifies, raises prisons and monuments from which lovers hear their chorused voices, light and dark, sounding through wind-hollowed epochs.
I dance the fusion of water and sand that dissolves and filters, sculpts caverns where lovers learn of solitude and mystery.
I dance the fusion of lips and tongue and heart that invites, tastes, yearns, whole new language with which lovers trust their touching of each other.
I dance the fusion of firebolt and cloud that severs and disgorges, becomes rivers where lovers yearn of wandering and return.
I dance the fusion of tree and rock that cleaves and clings, congregates glades where lovers stretch limb unto limb.
I dance the fusion of festering carnage and willing sacrifice that terrifies and honors, kills and heals, forge bonds where lovers dare to shed blood into one another.
I dance the fusion of today and this place, that eternities and kingdoms the present, yoke of consummation where love is incarnate.
Come under the board's blue of day and stand amid the sunshine of chip down. Let pollen cling until we are golden with its dustings and our pores be as pollen-filled honeycomb. Let us come to each other and transform the fertile stores into love's honey potion. Let us be blanketed by gown drifts of redbud blooms, elm flowerings, weesach. Let the spider's first webs be our nuptial canopy. Let us be entangled in twinings of mustang and morning glories. Let us fly to the river's headwaters where your love will grow strong. And I will open my secrets and we will not go beyond the words of each other's wounds. Let us lounge in each other until we become shadow dancing shadow on lichen-flecked tree trunks.
During his previous monologue, the playwright has written a beautiful description of a dance between she and self as they are united. And following the dance, she rises, self settles down into a meditative pose, and she returns to the house where she gets mail from the mailbox, drops one piece of mail but fails to take notice, hurriedly goes through the other mail and opens one, finds a locket which she opens, reads a note, and then breaks into tears. Cynthia enters. You dropped a letter, Maggie.
So you got my card.
I came as soon as I could. I wasn't expecting to find you in tears.
I just got a letter from my girls.
And?
They're wondering how I am.
Exactly. And how are you?
Great.
So you're moving back. Coming home anytime soon?
Don't think so. Let me read you something that I wrote. The always home. Neither homestead nor family tree. Home at your center. In your dance of your daring. Home that is and caverns, cleft of flint headwaters, before the storm stillness home, where words loosen from their meanings and peel like bark from trees, becoming the stuff of earth. Everywhere home, the vision stuff for making, making out of dreams, out of passion, out of longing, a sovereign life. When I'm with words, I feel so home-centered. Wrapped in a shawl, the weave of gardenia silk, shimmers of mother of pearl. I rest. Enjoy who I become. I am content to put each season on in its turn. I follow only the call of longing. For sure, a different Maggie. Yes, one with a mind to speak.
That'll take some getting used to.
For me too. Listen, you're spending the night, I hope.
You bet. We've got some catching up to do.
The character earlier in the play that comes back again is actually a Hispanic woman. And Maggie and Cynthia are very good friends, of which Paul, the husband, is extremely jealous. There's a great deal of racial tension. So it was very important for Maggie's becoming whole again to be able to integrate within herself that dear friendship that she had. Also, I found it very difficult to find a white way. So I used, even though I'm not strictly of a Catholic background, I used the Catholic and the Hispanic tradition for this woman to become a whole human being again. And I think sometimes the psychic traditions that we create within ourselves as women look slightly insane. And so I thought if I put it into another kind of tradition that's recognized and is legit, then I can go on and incorporate. For instance, one of the poems that we left out is her blessing after they leave the church, the three, the self and Maggie, and she, who's leaving? The coronera. There's a ritual that is the mirror image of the ritual when she's at the ledge rock and she's attempting to kill herself. You know, she douses herself with ashes, which then is again repeated after she leaves the church. She is blessed and made whole again with a ritual of ashes. And that really sounds slightly bizarre in a white kind of tradition. So I thought, well, if I bring in, you know, if I put her in a neighborhood, and I actually lived in this neighborhood that I described, but if I put her in that neighborhood, then it will seem quite natural to most of the viewers of Texas for whom this play is not a comfortable play to see. Yes?
You were developing the part of the healer.
Yes.
What were some of the emotions that you experienced, or maybe a sense of growth which you experienced as you were working through that part?
Of the character of the healer?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Actually, I have a strong affinity toward curanderas. I come, my native country is Germany. As a small child, one of my fascinations was with some people called the Kräuterfrauen, and those are old women who go up into the mountains and collect herbs. I had always been fascinated by those women and always wanted to, you know, always promised myself I'd either be a bicycle mama at 85, a motorcycle mama at 85, or I'd be one of those kind of curanderas. So actually that works quite well because it's a part of my fascination and part of who I want to be as an individual, to have the ability to use those gifts that in nature have been provided for us to heal our spirits as well as our bodies.
The descriptions of nature and the smells and the colors are so sensual. I just love all the imagery. It's really beautiful. It's really well done.
Thank you for helping me with this.
Something else that I noticed, having come from a panel that was discussing Southern women and how in effect they were resolving that separation of self, the role that was thrust on them. And nearly all of them were saved in the same way that your character was saved, by the word. It is the shield and the lance of every educated woman, I think, in the world.
One distinction that I make early on in the play about Maggie is I clearly wanted the audience to understand that that part wasn't presented today. Maggie's own agreement with that system, Maggie is a compulsive, wanting to be perfect mother. I mean, she's got children at home, twins. She keeps goats, she keeps a garden, she does all of these impossible tasks by herself, and it's not at all a surprise that she comes down with migraine headaches. Mm-hmm. So, you know, but it takes that for her to realize that the undoing is really in great part her own. I mean, she does not necessarily have a very sympathetic spouse, but a lot of it she buys into of her own accord, because as you saw in the play, she's trying to buy love. As a what we call a natural born child, she wants somehow to grasp at the legitimacy that society offers. And the only way she can do that is being perfect.